Hi, this is Rod Saunders from Jew and Greek. I've been thinking a lot about Carman since he passed, and I decided to do a follow-up video about him. This channel is about Christian theology and apologetics from a charismatic perspective. That being the case, I would like to go over the lyrics of some of Carman's songs. The first one is from his 1982 breakthrough album, Some of That. It's a song called God, God, God. Here's the first verse. Now, obviously, he's describing Mormon missionaries here, but the first thing I want to point out is Carman's regular guy lyrics. He makes no attempt to be deep and eloquent. He rhymes kitchen with religion, which isn't really a rhyme, but who cares, right? It's the story that's important. That's a common technique in Carman's whimsical tunes. It's like he's intentionally avoiding any depth or any attempt to be seen as a serious artist. Almost self-deprecating. So anyway, on with the story. He's addressing the error taught in the Mormon church that God was once a man and that we can become gods. That's theology, guys. It might sound like a silly song, but Carman is actually addressing a very serious issue here, false doctrine. Then he moves on to the issue of hermeneutics, or principles of proper biblical interpretation. You take the Bible literally when it makes sense to do that, but if it doesn't make sense, then you seek out a satisfactory figurative interpretation. Very good, Carman. Then in the chorus, he hits the theme of the song, the divinity of Jesus. He's fully God and fully man. This is the doctrine known as the hypostatic union. More theology. Then in the second verse, he discusses some Hare Krishnas trying to convert him at the airport in Los Angeles. Now here's where my advanced age comes in handy. Younger people don't remember this, but back in the 80s, you couldn't go to the LAX airport without being approached by Moonies and Hare Krishnas trying to recruit you or get donations from you. They put a stop to that now, but it was a regular thing back then. Here's a clip from the movie Airplane to demonstrate that.
Hello, we'd like you to have this flower from the Religious Consciousness Church. Would you care to make a donation?
No, but thank you anyway.
Hello, we'd like you to have this flower from the Church of Religious Consciousness. Would you like to make a donation?
No, thanks. We gave it the office.
A classic. Anyway, the song proceeds to discuss the belief in reincarnation. When I was a Baptist back in the early 70s, many New Age ideas were accepted by people in my church, including reincarnation. This was before apologetics and counter-cult ministries became commonplace. Because I heard about reincarnation so much, my theology was messed up, and I didn't know the difference between reincarnation and resurrection. It took a little apologetics from an Assembly of God guy to set me straight, which is what Carman was doing in this verse. Simple, yet profound. Then the part of the song that really tickles me. He said that according to reincarnation, you shouldn't eat a Big Mac because you might be munching on your Uncle Tony. You see, Carman was from an Italian family in New Jersey, and every Italian in Jersey has an Uncle Tony. Hey, yo, forget about it. Cracks me up. What you need to understand is that Carman got saved at an Andre Crouch concert in 1976. Back then, there wasn't a lot of money in Christian music, and singers could preach a little and minister during their concerts. That all changed when contemporary Christian music became a big business in the late 70s, when Amy Grant and others became stars. Along with the big money came restrictions on Christian artists. Don't preach, don't minister. Just do your songs and sell your records. The labels didn't want any controversial doctrines in the lyrics either. Nothing that might offend, in many cases even to the point of excluding the gospel. But Carman didn't want those restrictions on his music because he wanted to do what Andre Crouch did, use his music to win people to Jesus and establish them in the faith. So he had to take control of his music and fund his own recording sessions. Which wasn't cheap back then. It would cost you $100 to $200 an hour for quality recording and mixing sessions. Then you had to pay the musicians. Then you had to print the LPs. This was before CDs and digital downloads. Then you had to handle the marketing and distribution. This was quite an undertaking for a young man like Carman, but with God's help, he made it happen. Industry people told him that he was going to wreck his career, that he was burning his bridges with recording labels and was doomed to fail. But fortunately, by that time, he was established enough to get some backing and pull it off. Carman's music always had that characteristic of no compromise. He said, "If you're looking to hear songs with hidden messages or veiled references to God, you've come to the wrong place. I'm going to say it long and say it loud." He stressed holiness and commitment. He had a Pentecostal charismatic quality to his sound, and he talked about the Holy Ghost. In this video, he teamed up with Carlton Pearson to create a fired-up church environment for his song, God is Exalted. Now, I'm not sure about this, but I believe that Carman moved from L.A. to Tulsa in 1981 to attend Carlton Pearson's church, Higher Dimensions. I mean, I can't see any other reason for a Jersey boy living in Southern California to move to Oklahoma. He certainly didn't move here for the music studios or to go to school. It's possible that he felt that since Tulsa was ground zero for the exploding Word of Faith movement at that time, that he felt that it would help him to get established better with the charismatic movement. But I know that he and Carlton Pearson were good friends, and he considered him his mentor. So I'm assuming that's why he moved here. At any rate, he left in the 90s before Carlton Pearson went off the rails and started teaching universalism. In this video, Carman covers the seven Hebrew words for praise.
Number two, Yedah. That means to lift your hands in response to what the Lord has done throughout the land. An outward sign of what's inside for all the world to see. A demonstration of our love. So come praise the Lord with me.
This was inspired by Daniel Amstutz's teaching on worship at Grace Fellowship here in Tulsa. Carman took that lesson on the seven words and made a song with it, followed by the video. True to his eclectic approach to music, in this one he used a big band swing style to do a Bible lesson, complete with choreography. And nobody could rock a tux better than Carman. In this next clip, Carman shows just how unwilling he is to water down the message and find the middle ground. Here he declares that he's radically saved.
No longer on the outside, on the inside I now stand. You see I'm sold out the whole round, completely born again. I believe on the third day Jesus rose from the grave. Well, the world thinks I'm crazy. I am just radically saved. Choosing this day, tell me who will you serve? Time to stand up, you gotta let your voice be heard. You gotta come out from among the rest. You gotta tell the gospel tale. Now you tell them black is black and white is white, and hell is hot and sin ain't right, and God is holy and Christ is coming, and righteousness will prevail.
Now, to be honest, as a musician, I was never terribly impressed with Carman's music. Most of it was pretty basic, and his voice was good, but it wasn't exceptional. What made Carman unique, other than his looks, was his songwriting and his presentation. He studied acting before he became a recording artist, and he put his acting skills to work to create great videos during the music video era of Michael Jackson, Madonna, and Prince. He did a little dancing, too. Then there was his Time 2 TV show that ran from 1995 to 1997, where he discussed issues like New Age beliefs, homosexuality, racism, eschatology, cults, drugs, health and nutrition, and peer pressure, issues that young people deal with. Going back to the apologetics topic, in one episode, Carman interviewed apologist Josh McDowell about the reliability of the scriptures.
How important is prophecy? How important is prophecy to you?
When I set out to refute Christianity, prophecy was probably one of the three biggest things that convinced me of the truthfulness of the Word of God and Jesus Christ being the Messiah.
How's that?
Well, the Old Testament is written over a period of 1,000 years. Okay. There's 333 prophecies about the coming Messiah, all completed in one person, fulfilled, Jesus Christ.
All those 333
in
one person.
Carmen, they were all written down a minimum of 450 years before Christ.
Then in 2001, he made the transition into screenwriting and movies. He said he trained for 7 months for his role in The Champion, and I believe it. In this final clip, Carmen is discussing the design of the earth and the cosmos in his 1995 song, There Is a God.
Or take, for example, the combination of nitrogen and oxygen in the atmosphere we breathe every day. It just happens to be the exact mix that life needs to prosper. It doesn't happen on any other planet that way. You see, the Bible says the invisible things of God are clearly seen through His creation. To believe this is not hard. If there's a design, there's a designer. If there's a plan, there's a planner. And if there's a miracle, there is a God. There is a hope. There is a light. There is an answer to all answers.
There is a flame that burns in the night. And I know, I know, I know.
This was at the dawn of the intelligent design movement, when most people were completely unfamiliar with this information. Carman was not only thoughtful about his music, but he was also thoughtful about life, philosophy, and theology, and that was all reflected in his music. He was a gifted man, a hard-working man, and a blessing to the body of Christ. I never met him, unfortunately, although I did see him pull up to a gas pump right ahead of me once at a convenience store here in Tulsa. I think he was driving a Jeep or something similar. The only other time I saw him was at a church service at Victory Christian Center in the 80s. Sharon Doherty prophesied over him that God would take him a different direction in his ministry and he shouldn't be afraid. This was prior to him going independent and doing the free concerts with big productions. Seemed pretty accurate to me. Anyway, that's just a little more info on the man and his music. He was the inspiration behind a generation of radically saved young people who are now middle-aged believers with kids and grandkids of their own, who learned about being sold out to Jesus by a man who wouldn't sell out to the Christian music industry. And for that, we're all thankful. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please like, share, and subscribe, and click the bell for future notifications. We'll see you next time.